Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the G2 Esports Class Legends Invitational. I am Sotil. Joining me here is Lothar, and we are coming off the back of a crushing victory for Tice in the previous game. 3-0 with Aggro Druid. We may have been a little bit dismissive as his ability with Aggro Druid. Apparently, he has been top 5 legend with that deck, I've just found out. So he has obviously built up a little bit of experience since that tournament that I saw him play it in.
Well, that was Seed Story Cup, right?
Right.
So
that's right. Yeah, Seed Story. Yeah. Okay.
So that was quite back, but quite back in time, I mean. But in general, I feel like we had this amount of emotions in the first match between Zetalot and Sivka, like going so high up, and then Tice just crushed Colento, and we went down in being hyped about this match, kinda. But now we'll have a match between the world champion Oskaka, who apparently didn't sleep at all today, and he'll be facing against Ekop. And just before we jump to the game, let's explain the rules again. Do you want to do it?
Sure. So the rules, as I understand, we have a best of 5 format. Each player has to pick one individual class, and they can then build 2 decks from that class. Those decks can be identical if they'd like, but we don't really see any reason why you'd do that.
Exactly.
So ideally, you're going to bring 2 different versions of the same class, and you're matched up best of 5 style against another player. The winning player must keep their same deck, but the losing player has the option to either keep with the same deck they lost with or switch to their alternate deck.
Exactly. So the idea of this format is to bring out the best of one class to have like particularly good matchups against a archetype you are facing against, and you have a chance to redeem yourself if you have a bad draw, if you lost by an incredible RNG, because you have a chance to queue up with the same deck against to try again your better matchups. So in general, I think it's a format that is favoring, first of all, a player that is comfortable with a certain class, and second of all, he is capable of building a strategy revolving around being good in overall matchups, right? So
the G2 Class Legends created a strategy involving...
Use the code G2 Class Legends for 10% off of your Dust enchanting classes, enchanting cards. I mean, I think it's an interesting format, and for now it seems like everyone is bringing everything apart from Paladin.
Yeah, that's really interesting.
Right? Because I was predicting like maybe everyone will go for the Paladin because it's Secret Paladin, and it can just win games by playing 1-8 minions on curve, right? And from basically Zombie Chow to Tyrion, right? If that's the case. But it seems like people are leaning towards other classes. And now we see that Oskaka will be playing Mage, while Ekop will be playing Warlock. So far, we had three Warlocks.
Yes.
3 Warlocks, a Druid, a Priest, and a Mage. So it seems like Warlock is being the theme so far, but it's losing.
Pretty interesting. Mage is definitely another class that was on my radar. It's one of the classes that you can play a control deck of. You can either bring, you know, Freeze Mage, Reno Mage, some sort of Grinder Mage, plus either Tempo Mage or Mech Mage, etc. So you have that nice dichotomy between the two decks in the same way that Warlock does with a Zoo deck and a Control Warlock deck. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely one of the classes that was on my radar, but Warlock definitely seems like the power pick here. And it looks like Ekop has used this opportunity to put some tech cards into his deck here. It looks like we have a Reno Lock, but it's a Reno Lock
with
carrying
Kazan
Mystic.
And it's a perfect card in this particular matchup. Look at that. Oh, by the way, guys, remember to use the hashtag G2CL to tweet something about the tournament and get your tweet on screen, because it's cool to be famous for a short period of time.
It sure is. Oskaka here is going to have a challenge on his hands, because he is up against a Kezan Mystic here, but one of the strengths of a really strong Freeze Mage player, a lot of games with Freeze Mage, just because of the nature of the deck, by, say, turn 8 or turn 9 or whatever, you seem to have sort of the auto win. You know, you have a nice block up, you have Alexstrasza in your hand, you have enough burn, etc. But in those situations, the really good freeze mage players will make slightly weird looking plays that also have the added benefit of being able to beat Kezzan Mystic. Just it, like, because that's the only thing you lose to in those kind of situations. So it'll be really interesting to see if this game goes down that sort of line and whether Oskaka can put himself in a situation, make the read to come up with a play that beats Kezzan. Obviously, really, really difficult to do in any situation. Kezzan is just kind of the natural predator of Freeze Mage. But if anyone can do it, Oskaka can. Definitely an extremely gifted and talented Freeze Mage player.
Yeah, that's true. But what I'm also interested in is that how Ekop will queue up that Kezzan Mystic. Because in general, you can just play it first time you see a secret on board and you just instantly grab it. But I think the correct way of playing Kezzan Mystic is in this particular matchup is to catch your opponent off guard,
right,
to break two ice barriers first, mm-hmm, to for sure get an ice block, and you break the you catch the ice block just before your opponent will want to finish you, so he will be caught off guard without any protection from an attack and will just die immediately. Or he can't go with the all-in plan of winning the series, the game, by playing phase damage that turn, right?
Yep, absolutely. And it's also nice that Ekop has full information that he's playing against a freeze mage here. Sometimes mage decks can get that ambiguous start where they just like coin scientist into scientist or whatever. At that point, you might be tempted to steal a secret thinking that it's tempo mage, but this slow start from Oskaka makes it very, very clear that this is a freeze mage that Ekop is up against, and he's going to have full information as to what that Kezzan Mystic is supposed to do right now.
Exactly, and that's really important in this matchup to know, to have that knowledge. Will he use the silence? He sure has, right?
Yup, I like it. This is enough power to protect. You're also protecting the heal from your zombie chow, which, you know, isn't too relevant. It's going to go off at some point, more than likely to heal your opponent, but it's a decent board to be able to protect here with the Iron Beak Owl. And he's certainly not going to be wanting to use the owl to silence any secrets or anything like that. Mad scientists or anything like that, because he has the Kezzan Mystic to answer that situation anyway. So this looks like a pretty solid owl here, but Oskaka definitely has the ability to keep going here with the Blizzard into Flamestrike line. He can also decide that this board isn't too aggressive right now and choose to draw some cards, but I think he'll end up overdrawing if he goes down that line. So just Blizzard to neutralize the damage, and he's in a pretty comfortable spot so far.
Stalag, solid pick. I was thinking about the Implosion itself too, but Implosion might be important to have an option to clear another Doomsayer.
Right.
At some point, probably, because you are kind of running low on direct damage in Reno Jackson Warlock, so preserving that possibility of having an immediate answer against something on the Freeze Mage board might be very important.
Yeah,
but now it's very weak to Flamestrike, right?
It is, but you know, generally Freeze Mage has to have a very, very strong draw to get the Frost Nova Doomsayer on 5 into the Blizzard on 6 into the Flamestrike on 7. That's not something you'll generally play around. They're kind of expected to miss at least one of those plays. So I don't blame Ekop. The Stalag was kind of the only proactive minion he had in hand that turn. So he's kind of forced to play it out just to maintain the pressure. Does get punished by the Flamestrike, but he has a nice follow-up here with Emperor. And Emperor is one of those problematic minions in the Freeze Mage wants to stall the board. It doesn't necessarily want to remove minions every turn.
Mm-hmm.
It just wants to, you know, neutralize the board with freeze effects. But Emperor is one of those cards like Ragnaros that you can't really afford to leave on the board and so forth terrorize Freeze Mages.
Fortunately, it's not so threatening as the Ragnaros, right? Because you can immediately lose by leaving Ragnaros on board, while the Emperor, even though he will generate those invisible innervates each turn, they might not be as important as just straight damage to the face each turn, because you can't deal with an 8 HP minion, right? But in this case, we know that there's a Jiraxxus that can act as a heal and can also generate a minion the same turn because it's for 8 mana, so 10 to 10 can be that it can be that option. And also we know that the Kezzan Mystic now will be for 2 mana, which is probably even a bigger impact, because now Ekop will be able to queue up in one turn a Jiraxxus and a Kezzan Mystic, which will allow him to immediately deal damage from hand and break and just kill the mage if he is able to deal the maximum damage. To put the mage in range of the attack from the Jaraxxus. So this is a very important thing.
Yep. Even if Oskaka gets the full lockout with the board frozen and even the face frozen, because I believe Jaraxxus unfreezes your hero when you play it as well.
Yes, so. That's correct. I never saw that in a tournament.
Right.
But it's a really cool thing that you mentioned that.
Yeah. So even in that full lockout situation, he'll be able to immediately just seal the game with the Kezan Jaraxxus combination. The only thing he'll have to look out for is this situation you're looking at right now. He needs to have a space on the board to be able to play Jaraxxus and Kezan Mystic. One space will be fine because he can play the Jaraxxus first, and then that space is used and then disappears, and then he can play the Kezan afterwards. But if his board is full, he won't be able to make that play.
Yeah, that's another good point. Well, he always can use a Mortal Coil.
Right.
Because I'm sure there's one in the deck. Mm-hmm. He can use also Shadow Flame if he wants to.
There's a lot of things.
Yeah. Or you can just twist and narrow that.
Wow, all right. Oskaka is just going in here. He's decided that Emperor has done his damage and there's no point playing the control game here. So we have 28 health. There is 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 damage on board. So we're not quite getting to the situation where we're threatening lethal from Ecop's side, but this is a lot of damage being pushed through already. But he does have to be a little worried because of that extremely aggressive play that...
I guess that's the reason why you have to use Siphon Soul this turn on, I guess, even your own minion, just to have an option next turn to get a Healbot or the Kezan Mystic, right?
Yep, completely agree. I think Siphon Souling one of your imps here is the play. It gives you the option for Jaraxxus to heal next turn. It gives you an option for a top decked Healbot to be played or a top decked Reno. The important thing is that you need to have that space on your board, and you might as well, while you have nothing to do this turn, you might as well invest that 4 mana while you have the chance.
The only problem is that you lose to a Antonidas, because you have no answer to him, right?
Yep, that's also true. I could understand not using Siphon Soul for that reason, because you don't have an answer to Antonidas, but I think if you're going to use the Siphon Soul, I think it is just better to siphon your
enemy. Yeah, exactly. I think so too, because you're being locked down by Frost Nova. You can sacrifice a minion. Mm-hmm. And that's a perfect scenario for Oskaka this turn.
I guess, he could potentially use the Hellfire here to clear his own board. That might be what he's looking at, but that's dangerous as well, because you're in the situation where you don't really want to be dealing damage to yourself with the Hellfire. I guess Shadow Flame is another option as well. So he does have plenty of ways to remove.
Yes, now he has an option to remove. He will have to kill his own Emperor this turn, but he has done his job.
Right.
Look at that hand. How many innervates is that? How many innervates is that? That's just like crazy.
Yeah, I'm not even going to waste my time counting, but it's an awful lot of innervates. It's about the amount of innervates that druids have in their opening hand in 3 games or so.
I think it's a deck.
Yeah.
But this is the turn when you play Hellfire. Shadow Flame and Demon Wrath, I guess.
Shadow Flame, Demon Wrath will clear the Emperor, yep. Only downside is it deals 2 damage to your Twilight Drake, which is not a big deal at all.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
I like that. That seems like a solid line.
The problem is you are not pushing any damage at all.
Right.
And that's the problem. Wow, a tap? Why?
Oh, well,
I'm really surprised by the tap.
Yeah, if you're going to draw Lilith there, but I guess that's a pretty solid line. Doesn't have enough mana to play it this turn after the Demon Wrath, though, so I guess he's just going to pass here, leave the space on the board.
I'm really surprised by the tap. Because that means that gives the information to Oskaka that he has a way of healing himself.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you won't be able to do that. There's something in Ecop's hand that makes him feel comfortable with the tap.
Mm-hmm.
And it might change the line of play for Oskaka right now. He might go for the Blizzard, in example, this turn.
I'm just looking at the line here. Well, if he does go for the 2-turn lethal, using either Pyroblast or a Fireball plus Ping, or whatever he decides his line is to throw up face, I think he will lose the game. Because Loetheb will come down, mm-hmm. which will force the ice block to come down in response as the only defensive play. And then Kezzan Mystic is just going to end the game.
Yep. Agree.
So this is pretty interesting. I wonder if Oskarko manages to find another line as we were talking about earlier. Okay. Looks like he is going to go for the defensive line using the Blizzard here.
I like that a lot. Yep. I like that a lot.
Draws two extra cards eventually from these two minions in play, which can stack him up some extra burn and some extra resources in hand to be able to race over several turns. And Ekop is in a little bit of an awkward position right now. His only really proactive minion that isn't situational, for example, you know, Loatheb you want to play at very, very specific points in the matchup.
Mm-hmm.
So his only proactive minion right now is Sylvanas, and I guess the Mind Control tech as well. But Sylvanas is such a dangerous card to play in this matchup. Because of the threat of just being given a Doomsayer by your opponent. He has already seen one Doomsayer be used.
Exactly.
So he may feel comfortable enough using it, but it is a very, very scary card to drop against a Freeze Mage.
But sometimes you don't have other options, right? And that seems like this is the same one. You just drop Sylvanas in the low tip, I guess. Because there's no other thing to do. Huh.
Does Loatheb do enough this turn? That's the question,
it's
though.
It's not the perfect thing you want to do.
Right.
This turn, but now he will put the minions with the taunt this turn, in this case.
Yeah.
So I would favor the Sylvanas instead of the low tip this turn, if you go for that play.
Yeah, I mean, you've already seen two Blizzards, one Frost Nova, one Flame Strike in this match, so you're kind of not really scared of your board being answered, but I guess he is just scared of taking too much burn damage this turn, especially since he has no answer to that Blood Mage Thanos on the board, which is buffing the spell damage. And we can see, like, based on the hand here, he would have had Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance, which would have been, what, 13 damage plus 3? 16? Plus a ping? But in lethal.
Yep. Interesting line of play. I'm not sure, now we'll see Oskarko. What will draw Oskarko? Because he needs to drop minions instead of the spells, of course.
Yeah, Healbot is a really nice draw here, actually.
Well, you can kill the Twilight Drake, so that's cool.
Yep.
Can pay, sacrifice first, of course, for the draw to see what you will get first.
Yep.
Ooh. Now this is way better. Is it 5, 9, 11, 14? Yeah, I think Emperor is the correct card.
Yeah, I think Emperor is pretty much safe here. It's a huge discount on some very valuable cards in hand. And with the Loatheb now already used, that's one of the key cards that he has to look out for already gone, so he can start to feel much more confident in his lines of play, knowing that he's not going to get locked out by Loatheb. But there is still that surprise Kezzan, which Oskarko is going to have to find some way to navigate, at least the possibility of a Kezzan Mystic, especially in this sort of... you don't want to call it a sideboard format, but it's a similar idea, right? You can afford to put tech cards in your decks more often. And so the idea of a Kezzan Mystic might be something that he plays around more often here. But it is still Ekop's final trump card in hand here, especially after having used that Loatheb.
Maybe Ekop also plays a Panda Brewmaster in his deck.
Wow.
Bounce the Loatheb and Kezzan Mystics back.
Nice.
And Reno Drexen, of course.
Oh, wow. Double Reno value. Yeah, I like it. But yeah, I mean, there is probably a great deal of healing in this deck. Probably a Healbot, almost certainly a Reno. And
is that enough?
Oh, that looks good to me. Fireball, yeah. Frostbolt.
Oh my god. Look at that. It's Kaka didn't play G. Well, I guess Ekop will replay the deck, right?
Yeah.
Because what? In theory, he seems to be favorite in this particular matchup between the Reno Jackson Warlock and Freeze Mage, but Oskarko pulls it out and he's just now 1-0. Interesting development, I would say.
Like, I mean,
if there will be one turn when Oskarko would have played the Ice Block, I'm sure after the Emperor, we would have seen the Kezzan Mystic as a defensive play instead of being an aggressive play.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's just... ultimate feels bad man moment for Ekop. He's playing a deck with a card that heals you for 30 and a card that steals Ice Block, and he still loses to Freeze Mage.
And he didn't draw his own Healbot, right?
Right.
Because I'm sure he plays one.
Yeah, he didn't draw Reno, he didn't draw Healbot, he didn't draw Farseer maybe if that's in the deck, and then Kezzan kept in the mulligan and an Ice Block was just never in play for the entire match. So
yeah. Seems that Ekop was not never lucky on this game, but I'm sure he will replay the same deck. I'm almost sure that his second choice doesn't have better matchup than this.
It would seem unlikely. Kezzan Mystic in a Reno lock seems to do pretty well against most things a mage will throw at you. Maybe if his other deck is Zoo, he's definitely going to stick with this deck because Zoo will just get destroyed by the freeze mage. So I see no reason for Ecop to switch here, but yep, looks like it is just queuing up the same deck, unless it's a remarkably similar one. We saw the Ooze in the opening hand in the previous game. No Kezzan Mystic this time. He does have the Emperor, which is a nice card to have early against Freeze Mage, as we discussed. And yeah, confirmation, this is the same deck from Ecop.
I would say that Ecop hard mulligans anyway. Even though the Emperor is a nice keep against Freeze Mage, mm-hmm. I think you have to get... Wait, what?
Whoa!
I wanted to say that you have to dig for Kezzan Mystic, you have to dig for Rena Jackson, you have to dig for those defensive cards because you know that your opponent will not be aggressive. And he kept a Acidic Swampus and a Siphon Soul and an Emperor. That seems really odd for me. I don't know if you agree with me, but it seems like the Mulligan was kinda... Never mind.
I would have crossed out the Siphon Soul and the other card and sort of stared at keeping Acidic Swampoo's Emperor for a while and then maybe ended up throwing back the Emperor as well. But yeah, the Siphon Soul keep seems extremely greedy there. I can see the reasoning behind it. You know, it's a reasonable on-curve answer to the around the turn you expect a Frost Nova Doomsayer to come out. So it seems like a reasonable card to have, but... If you don't have the early pressure to back that up, then Oskaka doesn't need to Frost Nova Doomsayer you in the first place, so that card is just completely irrelevant.
Interesting. But we'll see how that pans out. I mean... Oh! The ping goes to the face instead of pinging the Echoing Ooze. So what that means for Ecop, that means there's already a Blizzard in hand, but there's no Blizzard in hand.
There isn't, yeah. So, from my perspective, obviously Oskaka knows that he's playing against a Reno lock here, and one of the ways that you win this matchup, beating Reno Jackson being drawn, is the situation we saw in the last game where he was very, very aggressive and quickly lowered his opponent's health to below 20.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, you're threatening to kill them without even the use of Alexstrasza. So you're threatening, you know, you're forcing them to use their healing cards, their Hillbot, their Reno, etc., to heal just for, you know, 13 or 14 back to full health. And at that point, you can just Alexstrasza them afterwards. So I kind of like him being aggressive here and just using the ping to face just to do that one point of damage where he can. But unfortunately, his draw is not quite on the same level as what we saw in the last game. No Doomsayer, no Blizzard. His first really relevant AoE is that Flamestrike that's all the way out at turn 7.
Mm-hmm.
And right now he has an Emperor to deal with. And without anything better to do... This
yes,
time,
fireball,
I think
then.
I think the Emperor is probably just going to take a fireball. Last time he chose to ignore it, but I think in this situation, you're like, what else are you doing with your mana? Like, well, okay.
Oh, okay.
Nice.
So Frost Nova this turn, because it's basically a heal for 11.
Right.
If you play Ice Block, then your Mad Scientist... Maybe you just play Mad Scientist then.
Yeah, it's the other play that I was looking at. I definitely don't mind the Frost Nova here, but it's between that and the Scientist for me. Again, I'm very, very interested by Oskaka's decision here twice, just not to deal with the Emperor. The first time, he had no option to deal with it on the first turn, which I can understand. At that point, it's kind of done its damage, so he just decided to leave it there. But this time, he had the option to just cleanly deal with it on a turn where he didn't really have a great deal else to do. But the top-decked Arcane Intellect turns out to be enough to convince him to just make a more proactive play.
Well, that's kind of baffling for me. I mean, you're telegraphing the Flamestrike, right?
Yep.
So your opponent will just go for the insane value of just dealing damage and not playing anything on board, or just playing low tap and locking down your answer.
Yeah,
that's exactly what will happen. I would say you even want to tap. So many
bosses. Looks like he's going to play the Peddler as well here.
Well, he can play... Okay, maybe that's better. Blood Imp? Yeah, I would play the Blood Imp. Why not?
Sure. Maul Coil, probably not a huge amount of value. He can use it in the situations that we saw beforehand to remove a minion from his own board.
I wanted actually to click the hide button to see if there's any minion with one HP. But that didn't work, you know?
As far as I remember, there isn't. 3-2-3.
But he did choose the Mortal Core anyway. It's interesting for me because if you play the Blood Imp, you have a chance to get the plus one HP on your Lotep on or on the Emperor, which would put out either of them out of the range of Flamestrike Pink, right? And long term, this might be even worth more than the Mortal Coil that sits there just awkwardly in the hand.
Indeed. And this time around, Ecop looks like he's picked up a much stronger draw. We saw the Kezzan in both games, but this time he's picked up a much better hand of like tempo minions, and we now see the heal bot in this hand to protect him from losing to burst the other way. Mm-hmm, so this looks like just a matter of time before Ecop levels up this series, as long as he sequences his resources correctly here. Doesn't do anything too catastrophic like filling his board, but even then he has the emergency Shadow Flame or the Siphon Soul to be able to deal with that. Looks like he'll clutch this out pretty quickly here.
Yep, I guess. I mean, he will play the Fugin this turn instead. I was thinking about using the Heilbot if you wouldn't have a other drop to play this turn, because it's far away from... No, that makes no sense. I want to say that it's far away from Alexstrasza, because it's turn 8.
Mm-hmm.
And it puts a threat on board anyway, but...
Here's an interesting scenario. The Ice Block will be played this turn, certainly. Well, yeah, like 90% the Ice Block will be played this turn. He might choose to go down the Frost Nova line and try and get desperate with it, but...
He needs to play it because your turn 9 play will be Alexstrasza, so you need to put it before.
Right. So the Frost Nova comes down here. Ecop is theoretically so far ahead in this game based on his hand. Does he even reveal the Kezzan Mystic? Because it feels like he'll win this game quite comfortably even without it. So he can choose to hide that card for a further game, which is pretty useful stuff when you're playing against a Freeze Mage.
That's true. But would you deliberately not win the game that turn if you have that option just to hide the information?
I don't know, Lothar. I'm asking you a question.
Because I think it's like you can't really risk not winning a game just to conceal an information. So that Kezzan Mystic will for sure be played this turn. Unless... Night Scientist.
I said 90%, and here's the 10% chance that it doesn't get played, and Ecop has a grand total of 3 damage in his hand. He has no way to add extra damage on top of this Draxus.
That's an interesting situation, because you can't play the Draxus, and you can Siphon Soul one of the Mad Scientists to play Kezzan, but that makes no sense. So I would say that you tap and play... Wait, how much damage is that? Possible damage from Oskaka. 12 damage from double fireballs or Frostbolt, Ice Lance, that's 616 with fireball.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no way if you clear the minions to get killed.
Agreed. I believe maximum Freeze Mage damage without Emperor is 21. That requires 10 mana, which is Blood Mage, Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance. He should feel relatively comfortable in this situation. Again, he's kind of sat there. I was like, God damn it, will you just play an Ice Block so I can steal it? But now the scientists have been detonated. There is an Ice Block in play. So he knows he's going to get his Kezzan value at some point. But we are just going to go down the aggressive line here, I think. Alexstrasza is going to go face, and Kezzan Mystic will now end the game.
This time it will end the game, because you can proc the Ice Barrier first, the heal for 8, play around Vaporize. Not really. Almost. It's like one attack less. That would be a bit worse, but...
In this situation, my slightly silly suggestion of concealing the Kezan doesn't apply, because you are under threat of potentially just losing the game on the next turn to Fireball Frostbolt. So
yeah,
I totally agree. Just get the job done. Kezan Mystic comes down, ties it up one game to one, and I guess now that Oskaka has seen that that is a Reno lock with Kezan Mystic, he will feel like whatever his other deck is probably has a slightly better chance than Freeze Mage.
I would say... Probably that Oskaka brought a Tempo Mage as the second option, because it's so different in matchups in general. Because you lose with Freeze Mage, you lose to Druid, whatever form, right? So you can't really play two versions of Controlled Mage against Druid in one class tournament. So your other choice would be something that counters the Druid, and that will be the case with with Tempo Mage.
And there we go. It is indeed looking very much like a Tempo Mage. So Ekop back on the same deck. Oskaka switching to the Tempo Mage. Not the greatest opening hand. He's going to be looking more for that Mana Worm start, get the pressure going early. Flame Cannon is probably the only potential keep in this hand.
I will agree on that. And you just keep the Flame Cannon, because it's also great with a Sorcerer's Apprentice. And you basically, by keeping on the Flame Cannon, you still have a full mulligan, like if you would go first. And if you get a Sorcerer's Apprentice, you can use the coin and the Flame Cannon for the full benefit of being the aggressor. But you know, it seems like he moved hard mulligan away everything. And he has Mana Worm.
Yep, Mana Worm, hugely important. Huge swing in the win rate. I think like Mana Worm for Tempo Mage, Tunnel Trog for Aggro Shaman, and Fiery War X for Control Warrior are the three like single most impactful cards on win rate by having them in your opening hand for decks.
Yeah,
They're just such huge platforms to build from in their own individual ways. But yeah, I'm a little bit surprised the Flame Cannon went back. As you said, the Sorcerer's Apprentice combination with it. So they turn two Sorcerer's Apprentice, turn three Flame Cannon ping on an Imp Gang boss is just such a nice interaction for you. But he did choose to send it back. He got the Frostbolt in place of it and did pick up that Mana Worm. But Ekop has drawn a pretty fantastic opening of his own.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
You have a really good curve with the Imp Gang boss on turn three into a Sunfear Protector, Acid Disruptor on turn four.
Yeah.
And Oskaka has to be aware that there's the Kezan Mystic in his opponent deck right now, so you can't really play Mirror Entity on turn 3.
Yeah, you definitely won't want to play it on curve if you can avoid it, but honestly, can he avoid it here? I don't really think so.
Well, the Flame Cannon would have been perfect this turn.
The Flame Cannon would have been great, yeah.
So you need to go for the Mirror Entity, unfortunately for him, because Nexon has to be coin low tap to put anything on board, because if you whiff next turn, I don't think you have a way of making a comeback against a Imp Gang boss with the double Arcane Missiles you have in hand.
Agreed. Arcane Missiles, just against Warlocks in general, Arcane Missiles tend to be a little bit awkward. Against Zoo even more so. It feels like it should be a decent card against Zoo, but you just end up like popping the Nerubian Eggs or popping the first half of Creeper, hitting Imp Gang boss, etc. with Arcane Missiles, and just really nuisance card in this situation, just interacts incredibly poorly with that Imgang boss on board, and he does choose to go with the Mirror Entity here. So I think we're just going to see the Swampoos come down, trade nicely into the Swampoos, and then I think Tap and Sunfury Protector are both viable lines here.
I would say if you want to play Sunfury Protector, you play it first.
Then you can't trade into it, right? The Mirror Entity.
No, I mean you play first before attacking with the Imp Gang boss.
Oh, I see. Yeah, okay. Yeah, you're right. I think you're right, yeah. Go on.
Just wanted to say that if you put the Taunt on the Imp Gang boss, then it begs for the ping, which is completely tempo losing for the mage, because you generate a 1-1, and the minion has the biggest value anyway. But in this scenario, I would say that I wanted to see the low dev anyway. Interesting.
Yeah, I think the mentality here from Oskaka is that, wow!
Oh my god, okay, if you know that this will be the outcome of the Arcane Missiles, then I don't have a question here. Like, this was the best thing to do, because now you can hear about in the low dev into Dr. Boom, and a chance to stay in the game. So probably that was the high risk, high reward that he went for, and it actually works. So, right.
So never mind. The mentality from Oskaka there was that he's a god and has sentient control over his arcane missile. I think the mentality was, as we talked before, the arcane missiles are kind of awkward to use. So that was a really good situation for them with the in-game boss on one health. So I think he was just trying to use those cards while they were good right there. Emperor comes down, huge draw for Ecop to be able to do something competitive this turn.
Otherwise, he would have been unable to play Sylvanas, which would be a 5-5 trade.
Yeah.
And that's basically it, which is not bad, but you want to have bigger value from it, right? So now you have an option to use Sylvanas with Siphon Soul turn 10.
Yep. And speaking of options, Oskaka has an interesting option here. He can trade and coin Dr. Boom, or he can use his Flame Cannon to just press a bit of initiative, start dealing some damage to his opponent, and maintain his 5-5 in play. I think both of those are valid lines. If he's going with the Flame Cannon play, I think we Arcane Intellect and then use the coin to get the Flame Cannon ping done.
Completely agree. And I think it's correct to Arcane Intellect this time, because if your opponent will have a Big Game Hunter and you will trade your low tip for the Emperor, then you lose the board almost completely. And
right.
Probably lose the game afterwards.
Yep, makes sense to me. Ooh, he's just going to play the Flame Waker here.
So he's trading anyway. That's an interesting line of play.
It is. Well, obviously, his mind was changed by the Arcane Intellect. It has to be.
Because of the Archmage Antonidas and Coin.
Yeah, Antonidas and Coin play, and also just drawing the Flame Waker gave him something to do. But, you know, that is why you draw first. That's why that mantra has been hammered into your head as a card game player since the beginning of time. Draw first, see what your total amount of options are, and you might just change your mind and see a better play. And that's exactly what happened to Oskaka there.
I guess you have to use the Flame Cannon.
Yeah, it doesn't feel great though, right?
Like you sacrifice.
You trade first.
Yeah, you trade first, then you Flame Cannon, and then you play Water Elemental and pass, because you need the coin for the Archmage Antonidas next turn. Because you need double Fireballs in your hand to somehow win the game still, right?
Yep. Agreed. I don't see anything too much better than that off the top of my head. I mean, you can YOLO Boom and go face, but then you're just begging to get blown out by anything from, you know, Hellfire, Shadow Flame, Demon Wrath. Like, they'll all do a pretty good job of ruining that plan. Sylvanas, when she works, is an incredibly frustrating card. And Oskaka, wow!
Well, I didn't suspect that at all. Like, this is another high-risk, high-reward play.
Yep. Oskaka is just laying it out on the table here, just taking the risks, recognizing that he's playing the aggressor deck. He has to be asking the questions in the matchup. Can't be too timid, or you just give your opponent too much time to draw into their Reno and so many things like that. But yeah, this Demon Wrath is going to be so punishing here.
Oh my god. Now we can use the game. Now he has to play Reno Jackson. Or Siphon Soul.
Yeah, so he can siphon his own Sylvanas to steal the 7-5, which probably just ends up being the play here.
Why? Well, yeah, you have to probably do that.
Right.
I'm just thinking, because if you Siphon Soul your opponent, minion... No, that makes no sense. Never mind.
He just pings your Sylvanas then. So.
Yeah. What about if you play the Dark Peddler this turn?
Try and get a Mortal Coil or an Elf Launcher.
I don't know. I mean, that was another play from Oskaka, a high risk, high reward, and he was actually blessed by the bombs. Right?
Yep.
If the bombs would have killed the Sylvanas, and then minions will be developed on the board from Ecop, that would be disastrous for Oskaka. But now he lost the Siphon Soul, so there's no way he can easily remove the Antonidas next turn.
Ecop laughs, because if he'd have tapped on the previous turn instead of playing the Siphon Soul, he would have picked up that Mortal Coil to kill his own Sylvanas. But
anyway, when I'm talking, there's a twisting netter in the head. Sorry, I didn't see it.
Right.
So there's a way to deal with Antonidas, but still it generates the two fireballs.
Pretty underwhelming choices here. That's about as bad as it gets for this deck. In some situations as Zoo, this wouldn't be a terrible choice, but for a Control Warlock, this is pretty appalling.
Yep. Well, there's no chance you will get value from the Relic Free Seeker, right?
Yeah, I mean, I guess we just take Hungry Crab, because it's the only minion that doesn't die to Mage Hero Power. Yep.
Oh my god. Well, you only have one peddler, so you can generate more Murlocs from it.
Yeah, sure. Or in before Unstable Portal into Murloc Knight.
Oh my god.
Alright, so a little bit of a tempo Reno here. He does feel a little bit under pressure. That fireball draw would have started to get somewhere close to threatening lethal. So he's just going to play the Reno just to get a 4-6 on board. Pretty effective heal. And the game is very much in the balance right now. That Antonidas is going to be able to do a ton of work later on. He'll be able to pick up two fireballs with it right now if he wants to go for Antonidas Coin Arcane Intellect.
Yeah, I guess that's the only way you will probably have still options after board clear.
Yep.
So you have to go for that. It's an interesting turn of events for Ostkaka, because it had the outcomes of the RNG from the Arcane Missiles and the bombs were blessing him, so he is still in the game. But it seems like Eco has the control anyway, although Ostkaka doesn't see his cards, right?
Harrison Jones in Tempo Mage.
Interesting. Crazy.
I'm really surprised he's chosen to go with this line here, because this kind of indicates that he's more all in and just playing for the board here as opposed to the Antonidas strategy, which makes sense as your opponent has gone all the way back to 30 HP, but it seems unlikely that Antonidas will ever generate more than two fireballs when both Arcane Missiles are gone from the deck. There's Arcane Blasts, I guess, which can be used to maybe pick up more than two at a time. But that seemed like a solid turn to pick up two fireballs, force your opponent to have an answer for the Antonidas. But, I mean, he's still in a position. He can do the same thing again this turn if he wants to. But I'm just wondering whether we'll see that Harrison Jones-Jiraxxus interaction at any point in this game.
Probably not.
No.
Because it puts too much damage on the Warlock. But it's an interesting now situation for Eco, because he needs to deal with those minions, and he doesn't have an easy way of doing that. So,
Yeah, it's a very, very strange inclusion in Tempo Mage. Obviously, Harrison Jones, just its functionality is as a tech card, which means you can just throw it into whatever deck you feel like needs to be able to answer weapons at any given point. But Tempo Mage, not one I've really ever seen it used in. So really interesting inclusion. Again, just the nature of this format kind of lends itself to that sort of situation where you're including extra tech cards in your deck.
Agree. And three fireballs have been generated.
Yeah, so what do I know? Turns out he was going to get more than two very, very soon after the turn he turned it down. Been able to pick up three there. And he's in a pretty nice position now, knowing that Reno has gone. Three fireballs in hand. A couple of proactive minions still to play in the Flesh-Eating Ghoul and the Harrison Jones. Chose to pull back the Flesh-Eating Ghoul that turn, which is kind of interesting. I guess he's just scared of the Twisting Nether, right? Yeah.
I mean, even if there's no Twisting Nether, there's also a chance of being Shadow Flamed, and that kills the ghoul anyway. And when you combine that with a Dark Bomb... No, wait, we already saw Dark Bomb. So, what are the other options? Hellfire and Mortal Coil Demon Wrath.
So we saw the Demon Wrath already as well, though. That was used on the Sylvanas turn with the Boom Bolt.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah.
The board clear options are actually pretty limited, so I think it is just a hard read on Twisting Nether not to play the Flesh-Eating Ghoul there, because otherwise you're asking for a pretty unrealistic combination of cards to deal with the situation. And there is, in fact, the Twisting Nether, so Oskaka's decision to hold back that Flesh-Eating Ghoul is now going to give him enough resources to just immediately regenerate a very, very powerful board here.
And it's so much damage in hand.
Yup.
Three mana. You gain three mana from the Sorcerer's Apprentice. So, but you're still not able to play Sorcerer's Apprentice and three fireballs in one turn.
No.
You would be able to do that if you have the second Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Yes. That's very true.
So, would you go for a turn when you only play Harrison Jones and the Ghoul and Ping and preserve the Sorcerer's Apprentice?
So Harrison Jones, Fleshy Ingle, Ping, puts him to 20, puts 7 damage into play, which puts him to 13. You then have double Fireball Ping on the next. Yeah, I mean, this sets up lethal, so I see no reason here to play the Sorcerer's Apprentice. You're already threatening lethal if there's no answer from your opponent. There is no answer, but we do see the Healbot, which can prolong proceedings for a little bit. And Ecop does, of course, have full information what those three cards on the left-hand side of Oskaka's hand are. Yes. He knows full well those are three Fireballs, so... But, he realizes he's dead here.
He knows that there are three Fireballs available, but at the same time, he is aware that there's only 13 damage one turn.
Yep.
At least he thinks so. So, in case there will be a Frostbolt drawn for Oskaka, that changes the dynamic completely, right? Because he can then play double Fireballs, and that doesn't change anything, because it's still 10 mana with... the Sorcerer's Apprentice anyway. So. Shadowflame turn.
He's going to go for a big game Hunter Shadowflame. Oh yeah, I missed the Shadowflame in his hand. He does actually have an answer to this board. And that procs the Mirror Entity as well. So full clear here with the big game Hunter. Good spot from Ecop. I don't know why my eyes just glossed over the Shadowflame in his hand there, but it's a good answer. And now Tempo Hungry Crab will come down and dominate this board.
It's golden. Has animation.
Oh, hi.
Okay. I guess you just do that.
I mean, the Reno is gone, so Jiraxxus and Healbot are the options that are in your opponent's range. Unfortunately for Oskaka, Ecop does have access to both of them. So honestly, like, what else does your hand do right now? Are you going to Fireball a Hungry Crab? I don't think so.
I think you'd only play one Fireball.
One Fireball. Put into 12, test the waters for healing. Yep, I like this. I like this a lot. Makes a lot of sense.
The problem is now you can't play triple Fireballs in one turn if adopting the second Sorcerer's Apprentice, but you need to put a minion on the board just to make sure that the opponent has to deal with something on board so he can't develop his side, heal and develop the board as to be super efficient with the man, right? But it seems like it might be very hard for Oskaka to pull this win. Here, even though he has three Fireballs in his hand.
Yep.
Oh.
Well, let's play that and the Healbot. Why not? I think actually maybe Lurtheb Molten Giant this turn, because otherwise you're going to have trouble getting that Molten Giant out.
What about the Zombie Troll 2?
Sure. I mean, is it 30? I don't see any reason why not. Yep, I think this is the right line. He then has Healbot and or Jiraxxus on the following turn.
Yeah, I guess you can play it. Like you have also the owl to silence the zombie chow if you really need it.
Yeah, and I think both mirror entities have been seen as well, right? One was played on turn three, one came from the mad scientist, so there's no concern about holding onto the chow for that. So I see no reason not to just jam it onto the board here. And I think we are going to see Fireball to face here from Oskaka into him immediately losing the game and conceding.
15 damage, of course that's not enough to finish up the game for Eco next turn. What about if you don't play anything this turn? You just play Mana Worm and ping your opponent face.
I mean, that's a better play against Jiraxxus, I suppose, but you're still going to lose the game to Healbot that way.
But at least you play around one card out of two.
Right, yeah. Although actually, like, fireballing face right now would put him to 5, and then the Healbot would take him to 13, and then you have fireball ping, which wins the game. So they both just play around one card. Like, you just have to pick.
But if you top deck a Frostbolt, then you win against Jiraxxus.
Yes, which means fireball face is the better play.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. All right, nice. We got there, Lofa.
It took some time.
Yeah.
What do we got there?
Oh!
Hello.
Okay, never mind then.
What?
I'm really surprised by that.
Yeah, me too. Huh.
I don't know. I really don't know, because you lose to Healbot right now.
I mean, you kind of just lose to everything, right? I mean, you still beat Jiraxxus with the top deck Frostbolt. That's one thing. But yeah, you're just not really giving yourself any outs against the stuff that we talked about. So maybe he's giving himself outs against something that we didn't consider, but this seems like a play to try and get back onto the board, and there's no way you're ever getting back onto the board in this matchup. So I feel like Fireball Face and Prey was the line that turn. Otsuka saw something different, but that should be enough to lock him out of the game at this point.
Well, he would have lost anyway.
Yeah. Cool.
There was no Frostbolt top deck.
Yeah.
So, seems okay, I guess. But in general, I agree with you. I think the Fireball Face was the correct play to have still an out to win the game. Interesting.
Actually, thinking about it now, I think both Frostbolts are gone as well. Because there was one in the opening hand, and then he used one to generate a Fireball with Antonidas as well. So I think, actually, Fireball Face doesn't give many additional outs against Draxus. So I think he was probably just locked out of this game completely, but still struggling to understand the board control play on that turn. But Oskaka is just going to evaluate all of his options here. Crucial turn. If he can try and invent some way that gives him maybe 1% chance of winning. But it looks like his choice is double Fireball Phase. Does he have another natural Fireball left in his deck? I guess he must have with this play.
Well, he got three from Antonidas and he used one.
So yeah, he has one natural Fireball left in his deck. No Frostbolts. So yeah, this is his 1%. No Jiraxxus in hand, top deck Fireball, that's his win condition. So I agree with this turn completely that he's identified his out and he's played to it, but Jiraxxus is going to be game winning here for Ecop. And after dropping the first game in unlikely circumstances with his Reno Warlock with Kezzan against a Freeze Mage, he's come back very, very quickly and now leads 2-1. And it looks like this Warlock deck is pretty effective against both decks that Oskaka has to offer here.
Exactly what I wanted to point out. It seems like Ecop's strategy with just one deck seems to be very good against both decks from Oskaka. So quite unfortunate for Oskaka to be queuing up against a particular strategy that is involving countering his own lineup. But it seems also that Oskaka will probably stick to his Tempo Mage, right? Because the Freeze Mage just has almost no chance of winning, although he won in the first game, right? But it was a very lucky turn of events, I think.
Yeah. I don't know. I think Oskaka is a very, very comfortable and competent Freeze Mage player. And I guess once you have the knowledge that Kezzan Mystic is in the deck, you can start to tilt your plays a little bit more towards that. And as you say, the Freeze Mage has a 50% win rate. The Tempo Mage has a 0% win rate. So,
but it's too, like, the variance is so huge.
Yeah, I know. But yeah, I mean, we'll see what he comes up with here. Looks like he's taken a few minutes to work this out.
I'm not blaming him. It's not an easy decision to make in this situation when you're staring at a Reno Jackson that has good matchups against both of your decks.
Right.
It's probably about just few percentages for both. Like, the difference between them is like just few percents.
Yeah, agreed. But it looks like he has decided to stick with the Tempo Mage here, which I think is probably, if it is just a matter of a few percent, it's this deck that's a few percent more favored. But yeah, I mean, just a really good opening round matchup here for Ecop. He's teched in the Kezzan Mystic into his Reno lock, and straight away, I mean, Mage is the best class in the game to run Kezzan against because their secrets are so much higher value than everyone else's. Higher mana cost, higher effects, more impactful effects. Ice Block is just the biggest secret effect in the entire game. Like, nothing comes close to the effect of that card and what it can produce. So big, like, matching up your Kezzan Mystic Reno lock against Mage in the first round is pretty good going for Ecop, and he's in a very, very comfortable position here to push himself through into the second round.
Yep. And now it's, I would say Ecop is heavily favored in this matchup. Even though there is the Mad Scientist this time around to have that early advantage with the Mirror Entity, having that clunky hand for Oskaka might be very punishing, but the Unstable Portal might change this a lot if he picks up a free drop. Oh my goodness. Well, this sometimes happens, and he just feels bad, man.
2-mana Wisp. The infinite value of Wisp has been defeated. It's not infinite value when you pay 2 mana for it, Lothar.
Yep, seems bad. And now look at that. Zombie Chow is being picked up by Eco. Perfect play for the Mirror Entity.
Yep.
And you can queue it up next turn with the mind control tech. So you're on the curve, and
you are getting a zombie char, which will heal you for 5 at some point of the game, and I'm sure as hell that he won't have value from the mind control anyway.
Right.
In this matchup.
Absolutely. And he saw 2 secrets be activated in the last game, both of which were Mirror Entity, which makes him pretty confident this is going to be a Mirror Entity right here. 3 secrets in Tempo Mage is pretty uncommon. So the fact that he saw 2 and they were both Mirror Entities means that he probably isn't suspecting a counterspell. So yeah, Zombie Chow into Mind Control Tech certainly looks like the play here. And there it is. It is Mirror Entity. Mind Control Tech is going to come down and challenge the board. And looks like Oskaka will just continue to play along his curve here and just play the Water Elemental. He does have the chance to get some value out of the Zombie Chow. Now he drew the Sorcerer's Apprentice. That might not be the worst play in the world. Sorcerer's Apprentice and ping the Zombie Chow to trade. Otherwise, he's just giving up a free trade for his Chow to the Mind Control Tech. But it's still just a little bit weak on the board. So I think I just about favor the Water Elemental here, but it's pretty close.
I would favor it too, because it's easier to put minions on board. To put the Sorcerer's Apprentice and Cure Vowed with cheaper spells on next turns when Water Elemental requires a lot more resources from the Warlock to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
So seems like okay. Never mind.
Okay, so the other line possibly is just using both of those 1-mana spells for tempo here, and yeah, this looks like he's gonna make the push. Just about to bring this point up before he picked up the Sorcerer's Apprentice, he can actually go for the full board clear. It's a ton of resources invested into a pretty innocuous looking board, but it does put him in a commanding board position. He's able to follow up on curve with the, well, follow up slightly off curve with the Water Elemental next turn. Unfortunately, Mr. Twilight Drake is going to come down here and contest this board quite nicely. And with that Zombie Chow in play, Ekop has no real concerns about his life total. Lets him be much more aggressive with his plays here. But
he can't really also, tap.
Yeah, he can't tap, but he's also, I guess, considering respecting the Sorcerer's Apprentice, which is a minion that commands a lot of respect, especially if you allow your opponent to Arcanian Select for 2 mana. That's usually one of the strongest uses of the card. Arcane Intellect is such a clunky card to want to play in a tempo deck because it's kind of by definition anti-tempo. And the 4 roll from Ekop, wow. So, I mean, it's leveling out a bit here. He got punished by the RNG effects a little bit in the last game, even though he was able to emerge victorious.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess you could say he deserves the four roll on Implosion there. But again, that puts him in a very, very strong position here. Oskaka is going to have a think, but do you see any line here, Lothar, that isn't just play your 2 minions?
Nope, no other play. I mean, just wanted to bring up the point that you were saying about the Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Yeah.
I would not value it as highly as usual after seeing already Unstable Portal, 1 Frostbolt, 1 Flame Cannon.
Right.
And you are sure as hell that your opponent doesn't have a Flame Waker because he would have played that before.
Right.
So I would have played the Twilight Drake to just have the option of having an instant removal next turn alongside the Twilight Drake. Because that puts, in theory, maximum 8 damage to the board.
Mm-hmm.
In practice, probably 6. But it turns out the explosion went for 4, so it's a better play.
Choosing to pick up the heal value out of the Zombie Chow rather than respecting the Mana Worm, which... it's a little bit inconsistent, I guess. If you kill the Sorcerer's Apprentice, you're respecting the fact that he has spells in hand. And then if you don't kill the Mana Worm, you're not respecting the fact that he might have spells in hand. So, well, kind of an interesting line. But I guess when playing Sylvanas, he doesn't want the Chow on the board as a possible heal. So
Exactly. So he's taking the chance. He's taking the heal immediately just to avoid stealing it.
Right? Yep.
And then healing your opponent. Because that basically it's like plus 10 swing of health.
Right.
So when
you look into it a little bit deeper, it actually makes a lot of sense. So sorry, all right, Cup. I'll forgive you on that one.
But now that's an interesting situation. You just go face with everything and you play Dr. Boom next turn, right? You know that your opponent might... You don't know. You're not certain. But I want to say that because he killed the Zombie Chow, he probably doesn't have heal in his hand already. So he's so worried about the health that he needs to kill the Zombie Chow right now. Just to not get punished by the fact that he can steal it, right? So this might tell Oskaka to be like, the only way you can win this game is being super, super aggressive.
Yeah, definitely. it makes a lot of sense. If the Dr. Boom does come down on the following turn, if he's not able to pick up the value trades into Sylvanas to prevent the steal, then Shadow Flame will blow out the game, but Ecop has to find something to do this turn. He may feel even pressured enough to want to use the Shadow Flame on this turn, in which case the Dr. Boom will be extremely punishing as a follow-up. We'll see what he ends up doing here. Yeah, looks like we're going to see a Shadow Flame play. It's going to steal a 3-1 Water Elemental, but the Dr. Boom is going to come down and immediately contest that.
It will, but if there's a 5-drop... Oh,
hello. Boom into Antonidas Arcane Missiles.
I just wanted to say that if you pick up a drop alongside the ping, probably would have been better just to have... to preserve the life points on Dr. Boom.
Right.
And basically, it does the same by playing it one turn later because it's not getting frozen.
Sure.
Right? So yeah, the outcome is the same, but you spare 3 points of life on the Dr. Boom. But in this situation, it doesn't make any sense because you need Antonidas with Arcane Missiles on turn 8. Most likely.
Makes sense. Something like Azure Drake Ping, for example, would have been perfect.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, not much option left. Just had to play the Dr. Boom, and I think going back to Ecop's side, not much choice either. Just has to side control the Dr. Boom. So, four damage to face.
Four damage to face. Nice. Well, that changes a lot.
Okay, yeah. I mean, this hand says go in, so we are going in. Antonidas, Arcane Missiles to face. Push one more with the Boom Bot. Double Fireball in hand. And Ecop right now is going to have to find an answer because right now this hand is not sufficient.
M Gang boss is not an answer. Well, you lost.
not quite. I mean, Sludge Belcher, he's theoretically alive in some world. Same thing with the Defender of Argus play. But if the Boombot does any damage to face, then that is game over. And it's essentially game over anyway, because you're leaving Archmage Antonidas up on the board. But
you have to top deck Reno Jackson next turn.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you're dead. But even if you top deck Harrison Jones, Reno Jackson, then you don't have a way to deal with Archmage Antonidas, so it's like a perpetuum mobile with fireballs.
Mm-hmm. Huh. Yep. So Ecop is gonna try and find the line here, but I think he knows what's up. There is gonna have to be a Reno Jackson very rapidly in his future here, and maybe that might not even be enough, because unless he'd have to draw like an answer, like Ironbeak Owl tap Reno or something like that on the next turn, to both neutralize the Antonidas and heal himself. Because even if he heals back to 30 and just gives his opponent another full turn of Antonidas volleys, it's just not gonna be enough.
Yeah. So you check first for the bomb, right? It doesn't matter if you attack first with the Antonidas. Or that does matter? Actually, it does matter. No, it doesn't matter, because if you use the... You don't want to put damage on Antonidas, so if the bomb doesn't go face, then you use the fireball on the Belcher, right?
Sure. That looks right. Yeah.
Or you just play Ragnaros instead, so maybe it's better to... attack with the Antonidas then. Oh my god, this is so tricky.
No, I think I favor attacking with the Boombot first. I think I like your line, whereas if the Boombot doesn't hit face, you can just go for the ball control play, because there's a chance that if the Boombot does damage to the Twilight Drake. Oh, interesting.
What? Doesn't go for the win?
Yeah, he's gonna give up any he's gonna give up any chance of lethal this turn, just go for the full ball control play, which is pretty interesting here.
Okay, I'm kind of baffled now.
That is weird.
Why wouldn't you go for the 33% of winning the game?
Right. He does pick up the Dark Bomb here, which does let him answer the Antonidas, but unfortunately not enough mana spare after that to play the Jiraxxus, so this looks to be pretty much checkmate at this point. But yeah, just to go back to the previous turn. Does seem odd because he didn't do anything with that Boombot anyway. I can understand if he had an idea that he was going to use the Boombot for board control to maybe try and take out the Twilight Drake as well, but he just didn't use it. So I don't really see the harm in not throwing it into the Belcher first and testing your options, especially like you're playing against a Reno deck. Like he could go to 30 this turn.
Yeah, I mean we can put that on the card of Oskaka not sleeping today because he was playing Overwatch till 4 a.m.
Sure,
but. interesting development. I'm really, really interested in what was his train of thought in this situation.
Right.
Whoa! What?
I mean.
Wait. What? You're dead, bro.
Yeah, he was dead whatever he did, so. I guess he was just playing out the game, trying to extend it out as long as possible, but that is going to take the game to 2-2 now, and if Ecop feels like his other Warlock deck is more favored against Tempo Mage, which if it's a Zoo, honestly, he might even feel like that, because Zoo is pretty devastating against Tempo Mage most of the time, primarily because of the card Nerubian Egg, which... like Tempo Mage just can't beat. Like it procs Mirror Entity and gives them a useless minion. It messes
you
up
have
flame
to...
messes up Flame Cannon. It messes up Arcane Missiles. It messes up Flame Waker. Like everything. That thing, that one card just destroys Tempo Mage on its own.
That's true. Or you just give him the egg and the Tempo Mage needs to sacrifice 4 mana to get a 4/4 minion over the course of 2 turns.
Tempo Mage has to spend 4 mana pinging their own egg.
Yeah, that's not gonna work.
Yeah.
And
there you go. There it is. Cues up the Zoo.
Wow. So, I need to give... like, after the tournament, I will give a lot of thought about how impactful is forcing players to stay on the same deck.
Mm-hmm.
Because it feels like this might be putting a lot of counter strategies, right? Not sure if that's healthy for the format. I'm just thinking about it right now.
Right.
But it promotes clever deck building.
Yes.
And better to say clever deck choices. It's
right.
not about the tech choices in the decks. It's rather about usage of archetypes.
Yeah. And it also adds a layer of strategy. Like the thing we were talking about in the Kalento Tai series, where possibly he felt like he had to win 2 games in a row, so he was going to take a slightly worse matchup. That sort of thing. Whereas if it's just like random picks every time, then you kind of just enter into like a dice roll situation, right? So.
Double flame imps.
Nice.
What a start. Yeah. That's the perfect counter in form of Mad Scientist.
Yeah. So we'll see what Ecop picks up here. Abusive Sergeant. All right. That's so nice. he can either choose to deal with the Mirror Entity right now, or he can just choose to ignore it and try and deal with it with a minion later. And I think the Abusive Sergeant will be enough to convince him just to go face this turn. Then he can proc the Mirror Entity with the Abusive Sergeant on the next turn and just trade into the Abusive Sergeant with the Hornet Creeper.
Yep, good point.
And there is the punish for leaving Mad Scientist alive. He drew a secret. There is every chance that that is the copy of the secret that would have been drawn from the Mad Scientist if it was traded into. And then he would have drawn a different, possibly better card on this turn.
Mm-hmm.
So that is one of the main reasons why you don't kill Mad Scientists on your turns. You just let them draw another card that can potentially punish them. Particularly true against Freeze Mage more so than Tempo Mage, but
yes,
still valid.
Agree. But some of the Tempo Mages are using double secrets. I mean, sorry, not. It's incorrect to say double secrets. It's because they always have 2 secrets.
Right.
But there will be 2 different secrets in the example.
Yeah.
Which might be duplicate, which might be effigy, which might be counterspell. I like counterspell, to be honest. It catches people so off guard most of the time.
Ooh, that second Abusive Sergeant is actually really nice here, because he probably didn't want to play the first one on this turn, because he's still planning to use it to proc the Mirror Entity. Although he may choose to use the Defender of Argus now, because that will let him trade really effectively as well. But the second Abusive is just pushing so much damage, and now he has all the options in the world for dealing with this Mirror Entity on the follow-up turn.
Mm-hmm. Double Mad Scientist, well, that's unlucky. Unless he plays 3 secrets.
Mm-hmm. I should Flame Cannon first here, So doubles his chances of killing a Flame Imp there as he traded into one. Oh, not doubles his chances. 66 instead of 50. So good ordering there from Oskaka, and got rewarded for it by being able to kill both Flame Imps. And now he's actually...
I think you play Abusive Sergeant first, because if you play Abusive Sergeant, then you have a chance to Dark Peddler into Mortal Coil.
Ah, I like it. Yeah, let's do that.
Because you want to put as many minions on board anyway. Defender of Argus is just... Well, if you play Defender of Argus, you push your opponent to be off curve on turn 5, so he can't play Lotep or Water Elemental, because he needs to ping the free one. But I don't think that this is a correct play this turn.
I think this is just a weak Argus. I like your line with the Abusive Sergeant first into the Peddler.
Even if you miss on Mortal Coil, you put another minion on board, which might be, an example, a Voidwalker.
Right. And if you look at the overall chances of what you can get, Mortal Coil has the Warlock Discover bias in it. Like, there's a bias in Discover towards class cards. And then even if you miss on Mortal Coil, you can also get Elven Archer or Stone Tusk Ball.
In the ball. That would be perfect. Yeah.
But, so, like, all of those are totally fine. So you actually have a pretty high percentage of picking up a play there. So I kind of like your line a little bit more than what we saw here. But this seems like it's going to work out okay. He's just threatening so much damage here that he's almost forcing this 3-1 to be off the board.
Why okay? Because there's pink on the 3-1 and you have the Flame Waker. And the Flame Waker is a really good play when you push your opponent into play to play another buffs, because he was so inefficient with the Defender Vargas. That means his buffs are really weak in the hand. We know that there's an Abuse of Surgeon, right? But
there is.
But usually when someone makes that kind of play, that means he doesn't have that buff.
No, it makes sense. I follow the logic there completely, but the Flamewaker will definitely get punished here.
So it's like a mind game that Ico had in his head all the time to use the Abusive Sergeant on that Defender Vargas to kill the Flamewaker on turn 5.
Yep. All right, let's go with that. Ecop is just a genius. Ecop
I'm
is just
sure that if
straight
you ask
up
him
outplayed
now,
the world champion.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm sure if you ask him now, he will be like, yeah, of course, that was my plan. But in general, I think it was kind of a lucky play.
I think it was a little bit sketchy too, but again, he's in a very, very favorable matchup. So like when you're in a favored matchup, you have to take much less risks than you do when you're in an unfavored matchup. And I guess you could consider the peddler play a risk. Even though it's a very low risk, because as you said, you did just consolidate a bigger board that way anyway, so losing one of your minions to a trade didn't really matter so much. But I guess he was just going to take the consistent option, knowing that he had the Doomguard to follow up if he needed to. I think most lines that he took on that turn would lead to an eventual victory, but maybe slightly inefficient use of his resources, but he's still in a very, very comfortable position this turn, and that implosion is a pretty glorious harvester.
Imagine if that Dark Battle would have been a Knife Juggler instead.
Yeah.
Oh, look at Stone Tusk Boar!
Yeah, so, I mean,
That would have been perfect, the turn one with the Abyss of Surgeon then, back then. But this time I think it's Stone Tusk Boar anyway, or just Blood Imp.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think we can take Soulfire here just because of the Soulfire Doomguard hand combination.
Exactly.
The idea will be to dump whichever card he gets here on the following turn and then follow it up with Doomguard. So Stone Tusk Boar seems like the best bet just to push that one extra damage. Seems inconsequential, but he's at such a low health total here that one damage might just make all the difference.
And a 3, which is okay.
Yep.
6 damage in the face, I like that. You have potential 6 damage in the hand. Not potential, you have 6 damage in the hand. Because I'm sure as hell that one of the minions will die at least, so we'll have the place on the board to play both minions.
Right.
Seems like might be the end of the game next turn.
It's getting that way, yeah. He doesn't have too many defensive options here, does Oskaka? Loatheb can lock out Power Overwhelming if he's scared of dying through that method. Of course, Power Overwhelming, another very common card you take from Peddler, but you'd probably expect to see Power Overwhelming taken a lot quicker than we saw that selection being made. But
yeah, I agree.
You know, players at this kind of level will just deliberately consider their Peddler picks to not give away that sort of information. But he does play the Loatheb, and we now have...
Oh, look at that, Pio.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 14 damage. 2, 3, no, wait, 12 damage. Yes, lethal, go.
That's 11.
Is it?
Yeah, that's...
Wow, I can't...
5, count. 6, 11 damage.
Yeah, you're right. 29. It's 29. Just go, it's lethal.
But you play the PO this turn. To trade with the... with the Lotep. I would go for that.
Yeah, I think I'm kind of with you on that one.
Because you use, like, you utilize the 1/1s on the board, and you still have the threat in your hand. And now, this way, your opponent has a way of making a comeback if he somehow has a Blizzard in his deck.
Right.
And you can, or Flamestrike. And you don't know if that's the case.
Yeah. I'm still trying to work out why. Like, first I thought it was 18, then it was 16. I don't know what happened. I had a Reynard moment. It was 29 for sure. Whatever.
29 for sure. I'm sure of that. Yes.
Yeah.
So what are the odds for Skaka? What can he draw?
Well, not Arcane Intellect and Water Element.
Frost Nova.
Not Ragnaros. Not Flame Cannon. That is gonna be about it. And Ecop takes out the world champion
in a 3-2 match. Basically, what I was looking for English like context, but couldn't find it. Anyway, congratulations to Ecop. He pulls out a win with his Warlock class, and this is the first Warlock that wins today.
Yep.
Right. Correct.
Stan
lost against against Zetalot, and Tiles won against Colento.
Yeah.
So this is the first Warlock that advances today. So congratulations to Ecop. He will be in the round of 8. And too bad for Skaka, but seems like the decks were balanced against each other, I would say, right? The Temple Mage.
I think Ecop probably had the edge in that matchup overall. You know, his Warlock deck, we said, was like very favored against Freeze Mage, probably slightly favored against the Tempo Mage as well. And then his Zoo deck was extremely favored against the Tempo Mage. So it was only really like Zoo against Freeze Mage that could have lined up against him the way it could have lined up. So I think Ecop overall was fairly favored in that matchup. But just from Oskaka's perspective, it's just a point I wanna talk about, where Oskaka is the world champion of Hearthstone currently, right? But he's not a streamer. And you know Lothar, you're a very successful streamer yourself. Like, being a streamer in the esports community and in the Hearthstone community in particular is very, very important. And if Oskaka is not going down that route, it's really, really important for him that these kind of opportunities that he gets in these like small Twitch invitationals, and you know, the cursed trials that we saw previously, these major events, he needs to keep performing well in these events to kind of, you know, defend his title as a fighting champion and keep in people's hearts and minds as a top Hearthstone player.
Yeah.
So it's pretty going to be disappointing for him to go out on a first round exit here, but Ecop is not going to care about any of that business. He's just going to be glad to be through. And it looks like we are just about ready to go to a short break, and then we'll be back with the next match, which is Lothar.
Crane versus RDU. And this is worth noting that Crane that's actually his first broadcaster tournament, if I'm not mistaken. He's playing for London Conspiracy, and he is a player that is known for playing Patron Warrior a lot. And he was known for being one of the best Patron Warriors in the world in the pro players community.
Yeah.
So I'm really curious, what class will he pick? And for RDU, that's a mystery for me too, because I wasn't asking the players what classes are they bringing, just to have that surprise factor during casting, you know? But anyway, let's go to a short break, because we are 1 hour behind schedule, so let's go for it. See you after the break, guys.